Welcome back to another webinar. I'm absolutely thrilled to be joined by Dathan Ritzenheim. You know him, fantastic runner, multiple time Olympian, and he too is running the Boston Marathon this year. So Dathan, thanks so much for joining us.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Well, how you feeling? I think most of us are, you know, getting antsy for the race and excited and nervous. And do you go through those same sort of emotions that the rest of us do when you're getting ready for a big race like Boston?
Yeah, I think, you know, I think we, especially with the marathon, everybody puts so much hype into it. It becomes a bigger, bigger deal than other road races, distances, but, you know, and then it's Boston, so that adds on to it as well. But, you know, I'm still in that period, I guess. For me, 2 months out, I keep pretty calm still. So I had just had came off from a tune-up race, so I kind of got a lot of the nerves out right now. And so now I'm just ready to kind of get down to the nitty-gritty marathon-specific work.
Well, let's talk about that race. I mean, first off, congratulations. Nothing like winning a tune-up race to build your confidence. Is that what you kind of go into these races to do, is kind of get a fitness check and see where you are, or is it more important than that?
Yeah, I think a little bit for me. I didn't have a very good fall of racing, and so I had some little hiccups and just kind of beaten up a lot. So I wanted a race where I could go in and feel really good. I knew I was healthy, but I'm going to try to take the approach of maybe being in the past. I've tried to do a race in the three to six weeks out from a marathon and kind of use it more as a fitness gauge. And this was more to kind of just get me, mentally feeling good about racing. And then I'm probably not going to do a tune-up race now. Just try to be a little bit more conservative. I pulled up with an injury about 10 days before the race last year. And so I'm going to try to, I would use this a little bit more just to kind of get back into racing, maybe see how I was doing, but I won't have any races to use as a real fitness gauge before the race. So that served a couple purposes.
Yeah. Well, on this webinar series, I've really been hounded. Be healthy going to the race. I feel like for all of us, it's like, that's the thing. We want to do this training to get ready, but we sort of have to be careful so that we can at least get to the starting line sort of healthy. You talked about, you know, sort of going through those issues in the past. How do you deal with that mentally? Because I think a lot of athletes, they kind of get down on themselves. They feel really bad that something happens, but it seems like bouncing back or maybe having a different mindset is important. How do you approach that?
Yeah, it was really tough for me last year, you know, because I was so close to the race. A lot of times we get hurt kind of in the thick of the training, maybe 4 or 5 weeks out, and really I think that's where the damage can be done, because sometimes we always feel like we need a couple more big things. Mm-hmm. You know, like you always feel like I need a couple more things, and so you're right, it's absolutely more important to be 100% healthy and maybe just a little underprepared than to be prepared, you know, 2-3 weeks out, and then you come up with something. And I've had a lot of marathons where most of them actually, I've got a little something going on going into it. And a lot of times that becomes something that shows in the race day, unfortunately. And so if you can go in, you know, you can manage those things, but if you can go in not having to think about all those little things, you can just go with how your body's feeling on race day instead of having to think, oh man, how's my hamstring? Oh, my shin's bad. You know, whatever it is, you can focus just on feeling good and getting in the rhythm. And that's what I really try to, I think people just thrive on that when the rhythm's there and everything feels good and it's flowing versus having to think about, oh, I shouldn't go right now because what if I blow up my calf that's been bothering me the last 3 weeks, something like that. So yeah, walking the line it's hard in marathon training. That's what you do. I mean, it's not normal stuff, but at the same time, if you can avoid having those little things in the back of your brain on race day, that makes a big difference.
Yeah, and a lot of times it seems like it is, like you mentioned, we just get a little greedy, or we feel a little nervous, like we want to put the cap on something, or we want to test ourselves to build a little confidence. And it's interesting that we do this large body of work to get ready for the race, but we just need a little bit more. And it's like, if we could just temper that a little bit and trust that we are an athlete that can go out and perform on race day, maybe we can avoid some of those injuries.
Absolutely. And I think valid, you know, you're right. Validation, that's what we seek out of those big workouts. And sometimes it's really to get us there, not to show us that we can get there. And I think that's the mistake we make sometimes.
So in your training to get ready for Boston, one of the things we always talk about is how do you adjust your training for that course? Because obviously it's a little bit different than a lot of the other race courses that people run on. How have you adjusted your training, if you do, to get ready for Boston?
Well, I ran it in 2015, and then my training, I ran the whole training all the way up to 10 days before the race last year. And the big difference I made with those two is in the first one, I was healthy, but I had a lot of those little things going on at the end. And whereas the last year, I was 100% healthy all the way until the end. And so the big difference was exactly that. I felt like I needed a little bit more and a little bit more. And I was pushing the envelope last year, doing longer, harder things and more volume than I had ever done. Whereas the previous year, I was worried because I thought I was underprepared. Mm-hmm. But then I went in and I was a top American and I ran well. And I had a couple little injuries, but they were just kind of things that I could manage versus a big catastrophic injury like what I had by just continually overdoing it. And so I think, you know, like this year going forward, we're shortening the period of time for me to focus on the marathon. So last year I had a good 12 plus weeks of really high volume. This time it's going to be only about 8, but I'm coming in at a pretty solid fitness level already. So, but I'm trying to taper the first month that I guess I would normally have. Mm-hmm. And that's a little bit more similar to what I did in 2015 when I really didn't do anything specific for the marathon until 6 to 8 weeks out, and then I made the start line pretty healthy. So whereas last time I was kind of going at it from about 12 weeks out.
Yeah, that's being slightly underprepared, even though mentally it kind of stresses us out. It seems like that is kind of the trick, if you can be comfortable with that. In your training, do you do any specific downhill work to get ready for Boston or anything like that that's different than for any other marathon preparation?
So my coaches, Keith and Kevin Hansen, they have always done that with some of their other athletes. With me last year, we didn't, just to try to avoid that, but I was hitting some pretty hard workouts that were just very hilly. Whereas, we avoided actual specific downhill repeats, but we did some very hilly things. Mm-hmm. Now in 2015, I didn't do a whole lot of that. I did mostly just even stuff, and I actually did a lot of speed work because I felt like the downhill, I had talked to some older runners like Greg Meyer, who lives here in town and won in 83 Boston, and he told me that it was just that downhill, you're always overstriding a little bit and that beats up the quads, and so he advocated for a lot of speed. Mm-hmm. Early on in the training, and so I did a little bit more of that in 2015, and I'd say that maybe that's kind of where we're at right now. I'm going to avoid a lot of the hilly. We do hilly long runs, I guess, but a lot of the really fast-paced stuff, I think we'll probably stay off the hills for the most part.
And going into the race, one of the things that athletes always have questions is, how do you run the Boston course? You just mentioned that you were the top American at Boston, so obviously you know how to do it. How do you break up the course, or what's your thought pattern when you go into the race? What is your kind of race strategy or plan?
Well, I had one of my best friends, Jason Hartman, was fourth there twice, mm-hmm. 2012 and 2013. And I really tried to pick his brain a lot when I was first running it. And he said the biggest key for him each year was that he was fourth place was to make sure that he had something in his legs at 21 miles still. Because I think a lot of people think you get through the hills and it's downhill from to the finish line. And it is, but left in the legs, it really doesn't matter at that point. And so so I think what I try to do is try to gauge that effort enough that maybe I have a little bit more than I normally would at 21 miles. And that helped me in 2015. And I kind of laid off a big move from 21 to 22 miles because of that. Mm-hmm. And I did end up getting kind of gapped away. And then I felt like afterwards, maybe I should have gone with that pack, but I was playing it conservative because I didn't know where I was fitness wise. And so, you know, I think you have to be careful early on in Boston. It's okay to get a little money in the bank because it is downhill. But once you hit those 16 to 21 miles, I mean, any little overstep in effort there can really come back to bite you, I think. And so, you know, people, I mean, sometimes you've been going downhill for so long that just the littlest hill there at 16, you're like, wow, this just breaks up the momentum now. This is very hard. So being conscious of that is important, that it's going to get hard.
Yeah, I definitely found that when I ran it. It's just that change at 16, that just slight uphill doesn't seem like mentally when you look at it that it should do anything. But boy, you've been going down for so long that it really does kind of change things. And in a later webinar, I'm going to talk about that exact change from the rolling down to suddenly you're going to climb for a while. But I love the idea that you've got to have energy and excitement when you get to the top of Heartbreak Hill. You can't be exhausted at that point because then you can't take advantage of that run into Boston, which can be fast because obviously it's downhill and flat. So if you've got a lot of excitement, it seems like you really can gain a lot of time there.
Absolutely.
In your running career, one of the hallmarks has sort of been this mental toughness. You've always, and from a high schooler, everybody just commented on your ability to kind of push when fatigued and challenge yourself. Is that just born in you, or do you feel like you've developed it over time? What's this secret? And I have to kind of interrupt and say, you know, I'm friends with Todd Williams because we went to the University of Tennessee together. He's another Michigan guy, and I've talked to him at length about this. I'm like, dude, you are so tough. You're just so competitive and tough. Where does this come from? So is it in the water in Michigan or what?
Well, I like to think maybe a little bit, but yeah, I think there's a degree of both. I grew up really just, I guess I was just a really competitive kid always growing up. Mm-hmm. And so my parents, they were threatened by the coaches that kicked me off the team. I was a bad teammate. I was a blame shifter, and I didn't put up with other kids doing bad and stuff, you know. So I temper that over the years, and so I think maybe I fell into a sport that was more you're on your own merits, I guess. Mm-hmm. It comes from the workouts, really. I think at the end of the day, you have to, there's going to be a certain bit of it, you know, nature versus nurture, but the first workouts back, I don't ever feel that tough, you know. Mm-hmm. I feel out of shape mentally, I guess, you know. And so I think that I've tried to pull back the reins a little bit on some of the really hard workouts over the years. I still need them every once in a while, more from the mental standpoint, to make me remind myself of what I can go through and where I can go. And I can compartmentalize things, I think, pretty good. And so, I'm always able to break it into, I can put up with it for this long. I can do it for this long. So I give myself goals in races sometimes. And it's like this past weekend, I was like, okay, I just don't let the guy who was second, Emmanuel Bett, I don't let him get more than this much ahead. And then I'm going to get to this point and I'm going to make a push. And so I give myself goals so that it doesn't turn into 1 hour of just having to grind it out. I think I can get to this point and then I can shift in my brain to the next goal. And so I think that's helpful for me. And, you know, like, when I was a young kid, it started that way, and it does set a trend though. And so I think there's a fine line though in youth athletics between beating kids and, making them tough. I don't think many kids respond well to negative reinforcement. I mean, that's definitely not in our sport. Like, I don't believe in that. Like, if I coach people, I don't believe in the negative, you know, some of the other football culture stuff. Right. Like, I hate that stuff, you know. And so I never responded to it, and it never made me tough. It would came from somewhere else. So, yeah. So I think positive, you know, I always just try to think positive, and I think that that's helped me when I was young and now going forward.
And it seems like the idea that you're going to build your mental capabilities across your training cycle, just like you are your fitness. And so it's okay, particularly early in the plan, to not feel as tough as you will be later in the plan. And that's okay. And that you do pick and choose your battles of when is a day you're going to push hard and when are you going to kind of control yourself. That's just part of the deal of getting ready for a big performance, it seems like.
Absolutely. You know, nowadays you periodize everything in your training, you know, from what makes sense in the actual training to your nutrition to the mental preparation. I mean, you can't be mentally on your game all the time. You'll be burned out in no time. And so it's okay to have periods of time where you back off, and those workouts should reflect that too. Mm-hmm. And then there's time to get the nose to the grindstone and toughen up too. And so, you know, that's just part of the training. There's periods of the year where you should be hibernating, and then there's periods of time where you're turning into steel.
Yeah. Well, I think that's a good lesson for all of us, you know, because it's a lot of training runs. It's a lot of workouts. It's a big, you know, like you were talking about, it's a block of time that you're going to be specifically focusing, and you just can't be 100% invested all the time. You've got to have the balance, the stress-rest cycle, not just physically, but also mentally. Seems like that's really important.
Absolutely.
Now, one of the things you talked about was hibernating. I know a lot of people are going through the winter weather as they're preparing for Boston. You're in Michigan, so you obviously have a lot of that to deal with. What are your strategies when sort of Mother Nature begins to wreak havoc with your planned training schedule?
Yeah, that is definitely. But the thing, I always think that unless you're living in San Diego, there's a period of time where it's not great, you know, like, and for us, a lot of people, it's in the winter. And so we'll go to Florida, Hanson's group, we'll go to Florida, and that, I'm telling you, that makes like a huge difference. Mm-hmm. And I had other periods of time before I was with them where, I just did a lot of races in the winter time. And it was more to get, I would get a hold of my agent. I said, we need to find a race. Like, I got to get out of here. And I go and I spend 3 extra days or 4 extra days, do the race, maybe do a long run. And it was just enough to mentally reprieve me mm-hmm. from it and to get some quality in. And that's the problem, is you can always get quantity in no matter what. Even if I have a woman who trains in Dallas, it's the opposite. It's great in the winter,
right.
You know, the summer, it's horrible. And so you can always get quantity for the most part, no matter what, you know, if it's snowing out or if it's in the summer and you live in Arizona and it's really hot, whatever. But it's the quality that always suffers when things aren't great. Mm-hmm. And so being able to check off the numbers, I think, is important, because sometimes it just doesn't work. You know, I had a guy yesterday, and he called me complaining because his workout was horribly windy, you know, and it was, the numbers were horrible. And so I said, well, was it still the point of the workout, you know? And it was yes. So it's like, well, it doesn't really matter at the end of the day. Sometimes it does, but you know, if 50% of the time we get the exact numbers we want, and the other times it's just it's the effort that matters, then that's okay. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of the times, like in the winter, that's just what you have to deal with. And so I look and see there's people in the Northeast that can't go outside. There's other people in July that live in Florida that can't train great. You know, and it's just, you have to deal with the unless you live in San Diego, then you get 70
years. That's right. Well, talking about sort of having to modify training, have you made any training modifications anymore? Do you do things differently now? I mean, you're a seasoned athlete now. Do you do anything different nutritionally or with your sleep or strength training or anything you've changed over your career?
Yeah, things have evolved for sure, and I think you have to as an athlete no matter what. A beginning athlete is not the same as someone who's been doing it for a long time, and a youth athlete is different from a master's runner or whatever. And just a regular recreational runner is different from a professional runner. And so you have to be able to change over time. So for me, I'm still able to do as good a workouts at least from long standpoint stuff, marathon, half marathon work as ever before. I could do as good as stuff, but the speed is just not there anymore. And so I just have to be conscious, and I'm okay with being able to run 31-second 200s instead of 26. back when I was running 12:56 for 5K, I could run, 12 times 226 seconds and walk away not being, it'd be nothing. Now I can't put spikes on, otherwise I'd never run again. So I've had to adapt, in that standpoint, and I need a lot more recovery now. I always take a one day off usually in a week. It's usually in this, between 6 and 10 days, I take a day off of running. Whereas I never ever used to take a day off before. And to maintain some of the speed, I do a lot of strides now, and it's just enough to kind of maintain a little bit of neuromuscular memory, but the rest of, I'm not going for that anymore. I'm not really reaching for that speed anymore. And so I have to be okay with that and know that I'm going to not feel as good on some things, but other things I get as good a quality as ever. And I just make sure that I get a little bit more rest, and I don't sleep. The one thing is, you say the sleep patterns change. They do. And I don't sleep nearly as much as I used to, but I feel as recovered. So I'm not 70 years old where people 4 a.m., but I feel pretty good off from, 8 hours a night now, whereas before I used to have to sleep 11 hours just to feel like I could survive. Mm-hmm. But I think part of that's that I just brought the training volume down a little bit as well. I've tried, because I don't need it anymore. I've got 75,000 miles of, lifetime buildup in there. And so I get in shape in about 8 weeks, whereas before it took me a half a year to get in pretty good shape. And so I've just had to fine tune things. I think you kind of build the house and then you maintain it instead of having to build the structure anymore. That's there. It's more about keeping everything moving, keeping the wheels greased well. And there's a lot of time that I spend 5 days a week getting some kind of PT or chiro or massage done. And I spend a lot more time in the weight room, that stuff too. So things that whereas before I used to just go out and run 120, 130 miles a week and I could do whatever I want. Right. So now I just pay attention to detail, I think, more than anything.
And I'd heard you'd even gotten your fat burning tested so you could really dial in your nutrition. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, I got a FatMax test done finally about 5-6 years ago, and kind of realized that I was a really high carbohydrate burner, which is great for non-marathon distances. Mm-hmm. That's quick, good fuel. And it can be okay on marathon day as long as you have enough of it in the tank. But for me, I had to spend a lot of time, being able to utilize other fuel sources, trying to harness that, I guess. Whereas before I just, I would take whatever I needed at that time. And so now I'll use, Ucan, for example, on some of my long, easy train runs, especially when I'm getting started, when I want to not get as much of an insulin boost, right away in my training. So I'll do that. And then in my general diet, I try to do that too. Earlier on when I'm, like I said before, we try to periodize everything. I kind of go through a period of time where I eat a higher fat diet. I would never advocate for like a ketogenic diet for a runner, but something that's more, definitely a lot less, simple carbohydrates. And then, but then on the quality days, I'll still try to go aim for that, because I still think that at the intensity level that I'm running, even at a marathon, it's pretty important. And so it's more, for me, it's more about the training than on race day, really. That the whole picture. And then on race day, my body gobbles up whatever I give it.
Right. And, I think that's a good lesson for people too, because you can manipulate your diet slightly to encourage these physiological changes that you want. It's not that you have to do it all the time, but there's certainly good research out there to suggest at certain periods of time within your training, you can manipulate that. And certainly if you're an athlete, like maybe your unique characteristics, right? There's some people that they're just really high fat burners and they seem to be able to, that's their kind of unique traits. And then others of us, we tend to burn a little more carbohydrate than we wish we did in the marathon, for sure. And that creates that necessity to really dial in that nutrition. So that's pretty awesome to hear that you manipulate your diet slightly, but then also take advantage of those days when you do need a lot more carbohydrate to push, and you've got good sources like Generation UCAN to be able to help you in that quest.
Absolutely.
When you are talking to athletes about Boston and how to control their nerves and get ready, because we've talked a lot about kind of the physical training, even mental toughness and stuff, but there's another component to performing well, and that's just sort of mentally tolerating the buildup to this big event, right? I think a lot of times athletes, and particularly at Boston, right, because you get bussed, you wake up so early, you get bussed out, and then you have to wait around for a while, and then your race finally begins. It can, and of course, the whole weekend. Usually, we've got two more days of the weekend at the marathon than we normally do because the race is on Monday. How do you kind of go through controlling your nerves, in your any anxiety and sort of pressure that you may feel going into the race, sort of through the weekend and then on race morning?
Well, I think a lot of people get that problem, especially because you're in that taper time. So there's a lot more nervous energy because you're not even using it, you know, when you're actually out there running too. So I've actually changed that a little bit over time to where I've tried to maybe make my taper a little less aggressive, just so I don't feel. Now, physiologically, sometimes the science might say, it doesn't matter what you do in the last week, you know, you could basically run 3 miles a day. And that's true, but like, you know, your brain sometimes needs it too. And so, and so much of it's mental. And so I find that even if it's a little, like, I would never normally double 3 and 3, but if that's all that I want to get for the day, sometimes it's good for me just to get out in the afternoon and get 3 miles. And just because my body says, well, I'm already tapered, but my mind says I just need something to do to not think about it. And then, you know, there's so many things going on that sometimes we feel that, a normal person could spend thousands of dollars on the Boston weekend, you know, sure. You get flying in, hotels are expensive. They feel like they have to do everything. And all of a sudden you're like, oh, I have to race too. But now I've been doing a million different things. And so I think making things as streamlined as possible is important. And then on the race day, yeah, you know, you're going to be out there early, early in the morning, but hopefully, you know, you've had enough time and a few enough distractions. So if you can minimize those things and say, all right, my family's with me, but I'm just going to let them go and they want to spend, you know, 2 hours at the expo. I'm going to chill here at home or, you know, at a hotel, whatever. Mm-hmm. And just minimize some distractions. And so if it means building in some extra time for after the race or something like that, I think that's important. Because a lot of times we just say, yeah, it's on a Monday. I got to get, you know, like if you can take one extra day off, you know, of work, that might be a big, you know, thing, stuff like that. So little things you can do just to kind of make it a comfortable weekend. And so to avoid as many distractions, I would say if it's the matter of $100 difference to have a better flight schedule, right, take it. You right. know, like you're taking so much, you put so much into it for the months leading up to it, and you've spent so much money that don't make the little mistakes by saying, I'll fly in at midnight, you know, because the flight is $200 cheaper, you know, that turns it into a day of stress and fatigue. Right. And so if you can minimize that in the 3 days beforehand and the day, and then and the day of the race, it doesn't matter what happens the next day. They can cart you around in a wheelchair. But, you know, I think just those little things make a big difference in those 3 days leading up to the race.
I agree completely. Boston is such a unique beast for so many people. It's probably like when you first went to your first Olympic Games, right? It's just, there's so much to do and there's so many people and there's so much excitement and you've got this extra time because the race is on Monday that a lot of times people just wear themselves out. I remember I was doing an expo booth one time at the expo, and this guy, he must have been there 12 hours that day. I kept going, you need to go lay down, you need to rest. But he was so keyed up, and it's so easy to do at the race. But it is Boston, it is our race, so we get excited about it.
Yep. And I think especially in your first time, you know, like, mm-hmm. you know, hopefully you do great and you run well, and then maybe the next time, you know, you can make it, then you know what to expect at least. Yeah. You know, you can go and do some other things, you know, maybe not put as much focus on it. But if it's your first time, yeah, you don't know what to expect. So don't overextend yourself either.
No kidding. Well, thank you so much for joining us. Any final words of wisdom for those of us going to line up and chase you down the road? You might be a little ahead of us, but we'll try our best to catch you.
Well, you know, they can throw you anything at you race day. And so don't worry too much about the weather. Prepare for what you can. But if something else pops up and it's 80 degrees or it's 30 degrees, it can happen. So just be flexible, adjust the race plan, adjust the paces, and don't go out of control. I'm going to try to heed my own warning here on this. Start over the next 8 weeks. Get that start line 100%, even if it means you've got another 5 or 10% of fitness to gain. Get there 100% healthy.
Well, definitely words of wisdom for sure. Thanks so much, Dathan, for joining us. Wishing you the best in the race, and we'll be on the same road chasing you down, but hope you get there a lot sooner than we do so you can, again, have a great race in Boston.
Great. Thanks, Greg.
Thanks. Take care.